Donald, please.
Okay. So, John Joseph and I were asked to talk about the topic of gravity as the square of gauge theory. So I'm going to go first because I'm just going to talk about classical aspects or tree level. So most of the material I'm going to talk about is it comes from these three papers. So the first one is John Joseph's work with Zvi and Henrik Johansson, which was the first paper on BCJ at tree level. So the idea of BCJ at tree level, what you're supposed to do, the statement is that the scattering amplitude for, say, just pure Young-Mohs theory at tree level, you can always write it as a sum over cubic diagrams. So involves some messing around maybe with where you start if you start with the Lagrangian, but this part's trivial. You always make it a sum over cubic things. And the objects in the sum are, color factors made up just out of FABCs in the Lagrangian and the structure constants of your Lie algebra. There's some kinematic numerator, which in principle has got polarization vectors and momenta and stuff like that. And then down here, these DIs are just straightforward old scalar denominators, Feynman propagators. Now, so the statement is you have to work hard and find a bunch of numerators, Ni, with the property that any time the color factor is satisfied, Jacobi relation, Ci plus Cj plus Ck equals 0. So this is just some bunch of three diagrams, which are the property that their color factors add to 0. Then you find numerators that satisfy the same Jacobi-like identity. Okay. So, well, it's been proven now that you can always do that at tree level. You always find these numerators. Maybe you have to work hard. The advantage is, once you've got them, then it's easy to write down what the gravitational amplitude is. So Einstein gravity, for example, is the scattering amplitudes of this theory are the sum over the same bunch of cubic diagrams. And the objects in the sum are, you just take two powers of that kinematic numerator and divide it by the same propagator denominators. Okay. So that's BCJ at tree level. Now, there's one thing you can do here. It doesn't have to be that you double copy the same theory. So it's possible to consider different theories, right? You could have just pure Young-Mills. Or you could also cook up numerators that are good for n equals 4 super Young-Mills. So it's so you could also have asymmetric double copies, where you have BCJ numerators for one theory times numerators for another theory. Okay. So if you take n equals 0 times n equals 4, you get n equals 4 supergravity. There's a whole slew of theories you can get this way. Now, there's another theory here that plays a role. It's maybe not so interesting on its own, but it seems to be important to understand what's going on in BCJ. And this is just a theory with a bunch of scalars. The point here is that the denominators there, you're always told they're just pure scalar denominators, propagator denominators. So you can consider just a theory of scalars. You say it's got amplitudes Tn. And so over the same cubic diagrams, and instead of putting numerators, kinematic numerators, I just double the color factors. And this would be a theory of bi-adjoint scalar fields. So there's some bunch of scalars that happen to transform in the adjoint of two gauge groups, two groups. Okay. Now, the thing to notice about this is, first of all, it's proven. We know you can always do this at tree level. And it's all multiplicity. Right? So it doesn't matter how many particles, you can always do this. So, I'm talking about something classical here. These are just tree amplitudes. The classical friends of amplitudes is just a perturbative solution of the equations of motion. Yeah, that's really what's going on. So perhaps there's a map between the equations of motion of Young-Mills theory and gravity. So that's sort of the topic I want to talk about in this first half of our talk. Now, there's one place where we know how that works. You can see it in detail. And that's in the self-dual theory. So you can regard this as a toy model, really, of BCJ. So what I mean is, so we just consider self-dual Young-Mills, satisfies the self-dual equations, and self-dual gravity, which also satisfies the self-dual equations. Now, one thing about these self-dual equations is they throw away one polarization. So there's only one helicity left propagating once you impose these equations of motion. So A1 helicity. So no, there's once you're willing to write formulae that aren't manifestly Lorentz covariant, you expect to be able to write these equations in terms of just one scalar field.
Are you doing Euclidean signature now?
I'm being signature agnostic. Yeah, there are factors of I and so forth, but I'm just suppressing them to make my life easy. Okay, so let me pick some Lycon coordinates. So I have some. Let me see what I want to do. So U is T minus C, T plus C. So these are, and then let's say some W is some spatial. Spatial coordinate. Now you can write the equations of motion for these series. Well, it's very easy. So for self-dual Yang-Mills, you find that the self-dual equation implies, well, first of all, I'll pick some gauge, and then you find that that the rest of the gauge field is some sort of derivative of a scalar field phi. So this is not A mu is D mu phi, right? It's A u is D v phi or something like that. There's some mixing of the indices here. And you also find that the self-dual equations impose an equation of motion for this phi, which you can write in this form. So that's self-dual Yang-Mills. And self-dual gravity is very similar. Self-dual Gior. I write the metric as the full metric as some Minkowski plus some coupling constant, H mu nu. Then the self-dual equations of just or star or imply that, let me see. Again, I'll take H u u equal to 0, and you find that the rest of H are some sort of squared derivatives of phi. And this phi satisfies an equation of motion, which is the Plomansky equation plus kappa du phi dw phi. In terms here of these braces, it's just Poisson algebra, Poisson bracket. So this brace of f and g is du f dw g minus dw f du g. So, well, one observation is that these equations look very similar to one another. And in fact, if you go a little bit further, if you just Fourier transform these equations and you start perturbatively working on a perturbative solution for these things, you'll find that you generate the BCJ rules exactly. So the structure constants of this Poisson algebra appear in the Fourier transform of this equation of motion. Maybe I'll just write that down. So in Fourier transform, Yang-Mills becomes, let's say, k squared phi a. And so there's some integral in Fourier space. So there are some structure constants. Let me just call them big F, p1, p2, k, of this Poisson algebra. And then there are the structure constants of the Yang-Mills algebra. And then there's just the nonlinear part of the field, P1, P1, P2. Well, the Fourier transform of the self-dual gravity equation is a very similar thing. It's got the same derivatives. And essentially, it's got two copies of this structure constants going around the place. But it's not quite, I should say. So this, the way I'm defining these structure constants is just letting this Poisson bracket act on exponentials. So I'm calling this fp1, p2, some k. There's an integral here. This is an integral Einstein convention, e to the I k dot x. So this is really an integral d4k of the delta function, p1 plus p2 minus k. Times there's some sort of a bracket here, which is just the Fourier transform of this thing. So it's, I guess in this case, p1 u p2 w minus p1 w p2 u. E to the I k dot x.
Okay.
So this object appears down here again.
E1u, E2w minus E2u.
Times this this little phi squared, basically. Okay. So it's just this Fourier transform. So there's something here. It's a little bit surprising, I guess, but the structure constants of a diffeomorphism algebra. This Poisson bracket generates diffeomorphisms. So that structure constant appears in the Self-Jeol-Yang-Mills equation of motion. It's no surprise that it appears in the Self-Jeol-Gravity equation of motion. But really, this BCJ step of replacing color factors by something kinematic is completely manifest in the Self-Jeol story. So, well, that's quite nice. You can compute actual amplitudes from this if you're interested in that. You can compute non-vanishing amplitudes. And in fact, if you think along those lines, there's a relationship to the scattering equations, the CHY formula that we were discussing a little bit the other day. Okay. So that's the situation in the self-dual theory. But what about the full theory? Of course, it'd be great if I could tell you what was going on for any old solution. I don't know what's going on in general, but there is another class of solutions where we can identify this BCJ structure and relate it to computing scattering amplitudes. So, so this set of solutions are solutions that have the property that the metric can be put in Kerr-Schild form. So this is just, so it's plane gravity, just GR. So these Kerr-Schild metrics, so the idea is that you write the metric of space-time, full metric, as, so these are Kerr-Schild metrics about Minkowski space. You can consider other spaces as well, but I'll just consider the Minkowski space case. And the metrics have the property that G minus eta, basically, has this form k mu k nu phi. So this is an exact statement for some classes of spacetimes. And this k mu has some very nice properties. So k is a null vector, k mu. So it's a null vector with respect, to begin with respect to the Minkowski metric. But then if I just write, if I define k upper mu as eta upper mu mu k nu, I'll just make that definition, it's convenient. Then you find that the inverse metric here is eta mu nu minus k upper mu phi. Okay. So that's one of the really great things about Kerr-Schild, is that when you start out with a metric that's simple, usually the inverse metric is horrible. But in the Kerr-Schild case, the inverse metric is just as easy. So this is really nice. The other really nice thing about Kerr-Schild is that the Einstein equations are linear. So, and they just look like, zero is the factor two, which I'll put here. So I'm just considering vacuum spacetimes at this point. And this thing is some bunch of derivatives on H, you see, so I guess I can write this d mu d alpha, h alpha nu, plus d nu, d alpha h alpha mu minus d squared h mu mu. So the Einstein equations are really simple, right? There's just these three terms.
So h is kk phi?
H, oh yes, thank you. Yes, this is h.
So a question. This is a special choice of gauge for the metrics that can be put in this form.
But
is there an obvious generalization of this as a choice of gauge that applies to more general, just a general metric? Are there any nice similar gauges for more general?
Well, you can think of more general things, but I don't know, maybe somebody does, something that works for an arbitrary spacetime. So you can consider metrics which have the property that they're double Kerr-Schild. So there's another Q mu, Q nu, psi, something like that.
So is that do you get generic things that way?
There was a recent generalization by Abe Hart that uses two null vectors and another conformal factor as well.
Uh-huh.
And it has, at least the Einstein equations are only like fifth order polynomial nonlinearity instead of an infinite series.
All right.
So at least it terminates.
Yeah.
But is that only applicable to special metrics as well, or that's
in general?
Completely general.
Yeah.
Okay.
Donald, what's the invariant fact about the Riemann tensor that makes this possible? Is it that the Riemann tensor can be written as the product of two separately anti-symmetrized on the two indices can be written as, is it that R equals F times F?
I don't think so. I mean, these spacetimes are algebraically special, so they're known to have special simplification.
I'm asking the question, what statement about the Riemann tensor tells you that you can put it in this
way? Well, these are geodesic shear free, so they're certainly at least 3-1-1. They're type D.
I have no idea what you're talking about, but that's...
Sorry. But the type D ones you can factorize. You can factorize fast spinner into two parts. Certainly type N and type D, you're in this. I don't know if all type D are.
I think it means the Weyl spinner can be written as the symmetrized product of two component spinners, each of which is like an electromagnetic spinner. I think it's identical to that statement.
Well, the Weyl spinner can always be written as a symmetrized product of four.
Yeah, but I'm saying
two of them
just down.
These are two
pairs. So each one is null.
Yeah, I can't quite remember whether it includes 3-1. It's certainly type D and type 4. Solutions can be found in this way.
But in other words, whatever this invariant property is, already it looks like something gravitational equals the square of something not...
So certainly type D and type N right.
For type D, you just have one complex component for a Weyl tensor.
Yeah, and for type N.
And it should be... What corresponds in Jan-Hill's side? So it's one complex function.
Yeah, but I guess you can factorize it into two parts.
Okay, so... Right. Yeah. So these based on indeed, they have simplifying properties, and we'll see that they look a little bit like double copies of Yang-Mills. Obviously, what I'm going to suggest is, the proposal is that the single copy. I mean, if this is some sort of this has the structure of a double copy, there should be an electromagnetic analog which is a single copy, and the proposal is that the single copy is just A mu, which is K mu phi. Okay, that seems like a natural guess. Indeed, you'll find, one simple case to look at is consider stationary metrics, and you'll find that the Einstein equations imply the Maxwell equations for this gauge field, this A mu. The Einstein equations also imply, crucially, for this interpretation in terms of BCJ, the Einstein equations imply that the scalar field phi satisfies d squared phi equals zero. So in a sense, there's something very linear about these Kerr-Shield metrics. I mean, the Einstein equations take this very simple form here. So the associated single copy is a very simple gauge system. Maxwell electromagnetism.
I can't see the... is the equation just what you would have thought of as linearized Einstein equations if H mu nu was a linearized fluctuation?
Yes.
I can't see
them.
They are.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's... Yeah, the amazing thing is that's the full...
But you say this only works for stationary solutions? Is it
No, I don't say that. I say I mean, the simplest case, certainly, that we've looked at is the stationary case. There are cases where there are time dependence, where the thing works. I'm not sure whether it works in general for time-dependent Kerr-Shield. I haven't checked that. We haven't done that calculation. So my guess is yes. I mean, certainly the cases that I know about where, I mean, you have things that are pretty crazy. you can go ahead and do the calculations, and indeed it just works. Everything works.
Is it hard to check? I mean, you're just trying to match the Maxwell equations, what you've written down on the...
No, it's not so hard. I mean, I guess the thing is, I mean, we're learning about what these k's are and what these phi's are in general. So when I know what these expressions are, then I can go ahead and do the calculations.
Well, another simple case would be the plane waves.
Yeah, plane waves work. Plane waves are almost trivial.
Easily of this form.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, maybe I should move back over to the non-extremal edge of the board. Okay, so, well, as I said, I mean, we have a proposal. These things look like a double copy. But one thing you'd want to do is check that this really is something to do with the BCJ double copy given in terms of amplitudes. So does this... does this have anything to do with BCJ?
And I'm sorry, does this correspondence work for stationary solutions when you have an arbitrary stationary background, or just around Minkowski space?
Okay, so... Well, the story there seems to be... It's a little bit more complicated. The story needs some modifications, but indeed it does seem to work. Yeah. So you can play.
Are you gonna? Do you plan to tell us about the special case of Schwarzschild?
I do.
Okay.
Nothing to do with BCJ. Well, indeed, in a way, that's one of the ways in which you see that there's some relationship. Well, first of all, in the self-dual case. So you can actually connect this Kerr-Schild to self-dual in a way that looks very natural, at least to me, coming at it from the point of view of scattering. Of course, I've got to do something a little bit different. These Kerr-Schild, these Einstein equations are linear, but the self-dual equations are nonlinear. So you have to do something. You have to change the rules of the game just a little bit in order to prevent. The Einstein equations from coming out being completely linear. So it's very natural from the point of view of scattering to upgrade this vector field K mu to a linear differential operator, K hat mu, sort of the Fourier transform of a bunch of momentum. So consider metrics of this form, momentum mu nu plus K hat mu. The point about that is that the linear differential operator is sort of tagged onto a phi, right? So it can't move around as promiscuously as it would if it was just a vector field. So you'd also guess then that you should be able to write, say Yang-Mills field as a similar differential operator acting on a matrix big phi here. So indeed, if you just substitute these in to the Einstein equations. On the Yang-Mills equation, and make a friendly choice for this k hat, you deduce these equations, this Plobansky equation, and this self-dual Yang-Mills equation, directly from the same formulas. So this stuff, the self-dual stuff, fits into this Kerr-Schild story. And the other thing you can consider doing is, with Kerr-Schild, it's easy to... And there's a whole slew of solutions that you can just look at. And some of these solutions, one of them has a whirl line, which you can take to be moving just on some time-dependent trajectory. So this is some time-dependent whirl line, say, or mu of tau. So there's a Kerr-Schild form of this solution, which is there's a phi, and it's just what you'd expect. So if I have phi x is 1 over... x minus or dot u is the proper velocity here, retarded. So at point x, you draw the Lycon back and look at the retarded point. So
it's supposed to be a point mass moving along a line, or what?
Yeah, this is just some point mass moving along, or an electromagnetism, just point charge. And there's a vector k, which is let me call this thing here or. So it's just or mu over or dot mu retarded. So this leads to a solution of the Einstein equations. So this is work in progress. But what we want to do is consider the soft radiation. So I want to take a whirl line that has a sharp bend, and then it's going to be some soft radiation. We know that the soft radiation in the gravitational case is a square. It's a double copy of the soft radiation in the in the electromagnetic case. It's just a Bremsstrahlung calculation. And we have these classical fields. So, the story is supposed to be that the classical fields here double copy, and the radiation double copies. Now, what I haven't done is calculated, keeping this double copy manifest at each stage in this calculation. So, but anyway, I mean, this has really got the intuition here about what's supposed to be going on. The reason this thing is supposed to be working is essentially that you're doing something soft. The whole story simplifies, and everything becomes tractable. Okay, so let me then quickly mention a couple of interesting applications of this idea. So one very trivial one is to take this whirl line to be just static. So it's just sitting around there and not doing anything. So static whirl line. And then the story is, it's pretty clear. So the gauge field, for a static whirl line, by the way, so that phi just becomes 1 over r, the radial distance. And this Kerr-Shill vector, that one there, just becomes 1 comma r hat, where r hat is the unit rate normal to a bunch of spheres. So this a mu here is 1 over r, 1 comma r hat. You don't have to work too hard to see that that's just the Coulomb solution. That phi there in the scalar potential is pretty familiar. There's no curl of r hat over r, so this is just the Coulomb church. The gravitational analog is g mu nu is eta mu nu. I should put a charge here into the q there. So I should put a charge here. It's a mass over r, k mu, k nu. And that's the Schwarzschild solution. Just in these Kerr-Shill coordinates. So it's a very simple presentation of the Schwarzschild metric. That's just Schwarzschild.
That's just outside the horizon.
Nothing funny goes wrong in here inside the horizon.
Say again?
Nothing funny happens at the horizon here. So.
Sorry, where is the horizon in these?
It's just when this K mu, the first index here, the first one, is 1. So the metric degenerates when phi is 1, or when phi is when R is M, the metric degenerates.
Okay,
sorry. All right. So that's where the horizon is. Another application is Kerr. So Kerr is just as easy. So Kerr in these coordinates has a phi. It's got R cubed over R to the 4th plus A squared Z squared. So A here is the parameter controlling the angular momentum. If you take A to 0, you're just going to get a Schwarzschild back out. Now, this R is not, they're not just the radii of a bunch of spheres. They're a family of spheroids. So R satisfies this equation, those bunch of spheroids. But K, this vector, is just the analog of the Schwarzschild case. It's just the unit normal to the family of spheroids. So Kerr, the metric, then, is just, fill those definitions in here. The single copy is some K mu times phi. Now, the single copy it's just a disk. So it's just a disk of charge, radius A, thin disk of charge, with some particular charge distribution on that disk. It's a bit of a funny charge distribution. The source is a bit weird. And you can go ahead and compute the electric and magnetic fields and the pointing vector. It's perfectly reasonable solution to Maxwell equations. So, the other example, I guess I was going to mention, we already touched on. So, shock waves, PP waves just work.
Are the two solutions related?
That's a good question. Let me see. So the angular momentum here is mass times A. I don't know what it is in the electromagnetic case. I should compute that.
I mean, if gravity is really gauge theory squared, I might have thought that the phi you should put into the E&M or the analogy is the square root of the phi that's in the gravity, but that's not what happens.
That's not what you're supposed to do. It's because, I mean, the reason why I don't ever want to do that is that in the BC, in the amplitude story, there are propagators. You always leave the propagators untouched.
Right? No square.
You never square the propagators. You leave them untouched. Why is that? Tell me.
Locality.
Exactly. That's exactly why. Right. I mean, in many ways, yeah, a lot of this stuff, I mean, the three-point functions are the seed of a lot of this stuff. We also know why the three-point functions have to square, you know, the level of the amplitudes. That's its value.
So, okay. So you get the local structure maps of a well. The global structure, I guess, is less clear. Steve asked about behind the horizon, but a better way to say that is, you know, for Schwarzschild, you really want that to be a vacuum solution, something that's like exact Schwarzschild. We should use the two-sided crustical solution. And there's no analog of the second copy in the Yang-Mills side, right? It's behind, it's sort of through R equals zero from the charge or something like that.
Yeah.
And this is some similar story here.
Yeah, exactly.
The global issues do not appear to map in a nice way.
Yeah, not that I know of.
Oh, so what region of the crustal diagram do you cover then?
Well, R has kind of a branch cut, a bifurcation, so there's a choice, but you get two regions.
You get half of the whole crustal diagram.
Yeah, but how?
You can choose the half.
Cut where?
Along the past horizon, say.
Oh, okay. Yeah, all right.
Yeah, so let me see. I guess that's pretty much what I was going to talk about. I should just say that, so the shockwaves are nice. I mean, we know that they work. The PP waves generally work. The shockwaves are just a particular example of that. But that was work of Satomi and Okuri. And they were motivated, again, by the amplitude picture. So these shockwaves are known to be related to the infrared divergences in amplitude. So it's another way in which you see the connection to the amplitude story, BCG. Okay, so unless there are more questions, we'll switch over to the other driver.
Just one question. There's no way in which this is sort of the derivation of the amplitude story.
Well, I'm hoping, no, there isn't. I mean, there's some relationship, hopefully, in this story, but it's only in the soft limit of the amplitude story. So the amplitudes contain a lot more, and in a way, there's something, you know that there has to be a lot more going on here, because in Yang-Mills, right, the amplitude relations are, you know, incorporate the full, the nonlinear structure, everything. So there's some special simplifications in this part of the story, that's why it's so easy, so tractable. There should be a lot more that should be done here to see, you know, what goes on when you have stuff interacting.
Thank you.
Maybe it's obvious, but if you would just take a general metric, but linearized, and then order by order try to check this relationship, is that just the old amplitude story, or is there something that could go wrong at the level of equation of motion?
Well, it's not, I don't know. It could be that there's something that goes wrong there, because, I mean, if I just start with the equations of motion, and then, so for example, if I want to compute Schwarzschild perturbatively, I know how to set up this calculation. And indeed, people have done it, right? I mean, people have done it from the point of view starting with the amplitudes. But if you just, if you're very naive about it, you have a field there. I mean, when you're solving the equation, there's some field that's off-shell. It's always off-shell. And this amplitude story, it's very much an on-shell story. So it's not completely clear that that's going to work out for you.
The amplitude is not the equation of motion, but it's the action on the solution of the equation of motion with the boundary conditions of the outgoing wave. So the amplitude is a little less coarser information. You're integrating.
Yeah,
so you're saying it's non-trivial whether, say, to the next order. So I guess at linearized order, it must work, right? I mean, at the free order.
Yeah.
But then even at cubic order, it's not clear whether there's some vertical.
No, I mean, to my mind, the statement is there's supposed to be some choice of gauge. I mean, in a way, I mean,
it can't be an invariant statement because you can choose in the middle of the calculation to redefine what you mean by the field, right. Blah, blah, blah. So at the level of the amplitude, of course, it's a well-defined statement, which may or may not be true. At the level of finding equations of motion, it's a completely convention-dependent thing. What they're saying is that there's a particularly natural gauge choice where this kind of relationship might be obvious.
Yeah.
But it's not a God-given feature of the solution.
Yeah, no, that's
it's
exactly right.
It's the presentation of the solution.
But the question is there a gauge choice where you can
add
those equations of motion?
That's what his talk was about. Yes, right.
Yeah. Right. But it seems a bit strange to go in, you know, nonlinear order in these special metrics. The more obvious thing to do is to just go order by order in general metrics. I mean, anyway, that's another question that you
can have done things like that, and it becomes kind of opaque pretty quickly. It's not looking order by order. It just becomes pretty complicated. You know, you can build it. You can build a Lagrangian order by order that has these properties, at least for the S matrix. But the general structure to all orders is unclear.
There's something about this which is very different from what you do by just choosing a gauge. That the H here is like a product. Which is very much what you're doing in BCJ. I mean, you're saying that the numerators of the gravity diagrams are squares. You work in the Yang-Mills calculation to find numerators. That's a choice of gauge, basically, so that they satisfy these Jacobi-like identities. I think that one of the reasons why the calculations that we're talking about get so messy is because what you really want to build in somehow is this squaring relationship.
Maybe we could get Dvi to say a little bit more about it, because I mean, this is directly your question. They found in order to get BCJ to work manifestly from the Lagrangian up to 5 points, I guess it was, right?
But it
wasn't just that it was randomly complicated, but that you seem to need to introduce more and more and more auxiliary fields, right, in order to do it. So there may well be some structure involving an infinite number of auxiliary fields that makes this property manifest, even though you guys didn't manage to find it.
Yeah, that's right. It's something like string field theory, so it's complicated.
And it's just a string theory.
So this works in any dimension?
Yes.
So you have
the Myers-Perry, for example, they're fairly complicated-looking solutions, but yeah, works no problem. You've got different kinds of angular momentum that you can switch on in the electromagnetic side as well.
One would guess that the angular momentum is one is twice the other, hopefully.
I'll let you know. Okay, so maybe I'll let JJ.
People have further questions. We also have some discussion time this afternoon.
References to Donald's. One near and dear to my heart is the first non-trivial multi-loop example we found that actually involved loop momentum. So this is three loops. I'm also going to, and hopefully you guys can read this, I'm going to give you you guys get to be the first audience to have a private link to my Tassie notes from last year, which should be up here on the archive in the next week or so, but the URL will be bit.ly Carrasco Tassie. Of course, some of this stuff is standard textbook material, but I assume you guys have already ordered Henriette Newton's textbook from Cambridge.
I didn't pay him to say that.
Not yet. So what I'm going to do in the time I have, will not get between you guys and cookies at 3:15, is I'm going to spend most of my time making the case that this should hold to all loop order perturbatively. We don't know it holds solid loop order perturbatively. We know that it holds in very non-trivial examples at higher loops in certain kinematic regimes people have explored to all loop order for a variety of theories. But so what I'm going to present to you is a plausibility argument that there is, in fact, enough freedom in representation to find representations that satisfy color kinematic solid loop order. Okay, and so the theme is that understanding of Yang-Mills is going to give us understanding of gravity perturbatively. And the first point I'm going to make is that that it's not easy here, right? But it's also not easy here. So you can ask, what's not easy about perturbative solutions? Right? We have Feynman diagrams from our classical actions, so don't we have the solution? Okay, and so I'm just going to talk a little bit about multiplicity at tree level. And I'll draw a few lines. This line, that line, that line, this line. Okay, and so what's this line? This line's m squared because I'm going to do a log plot. Okay. This line is e to the m. This line is 2m minus 5 double factorial. And this line is m minus 3 factorial squared. And now I'll draw. So I'll give you some numbers. So this is 10 to the 8. This is 10 to the 18. And this is 10 to the 28. Okay? This is a number of interaction terms when you're trying to solve an n-body problem, classically. You have to write down this many interaction terms. It's nothing. It scales like nothing. M squared's nothing to us. So you can say, okay, so how many particles do I need? What size simulation of the universe, right, do I need to do in order to approach the complexity of 20-point, you know, number of cubic graphs contributing to, you know, just tree-level Feynman diagrams?
Classically.
Yeah, classically. Right. Okay, so what scales is exponential? So there are a couple things running around that scales exponential. One is the number of cubic graphs that contribute to a color-ordered partial amplitude. This is a Catalan number. It scales exponentially. This is the number of cubic diagrams that contribute to the full color-dressed amplitude, or cubic graphs contributing to gravity scattering amplitudes, if we've assigned all our higher-point interactions to cubic graphs, because it's 2n minus 5 double factorial. And this is the number of terms in the KLT expression of gravity amplitudes. It goes as n minus 3 factorial squared. Okay? And you can use this multiplicity counting at tree level to give you an upper bound of the types of complexity you'll have to deal with at loop level. You can just look at sort of the forward limit of 2L plus m particle interactions as, you know, an upper bound of the number of graphs you'd have to consider at L loops. And so things get very non-trivial very quickly, right? And this is why, in some sense, scattering people have employment, because after they figure out how to do something, right, and they saturate all their computational resources, they need another idea before they can go even just a little bit farther, right? And so what we're looking for is we're looking for ideas that can battle this type of combinatorial complexity, right? And this is something that we're hoping we're starting to find with these Jacobi relations. And I'll make the case, I'll make the case that it's better than that, that after you saturate the available representation freedom to make Jacobi's manifest at tree level, there's an ever-growing more gauge freedom as multiplicity increases, and what's that sitting around for? I think that's sitting around to make Jacobi's manifest at loop level. Okay, and there's something very spectacular about making these Jacobi's manifest at loop level, which is you need to consider a very small subset of the information you normally think of in terms of the number of graphs. Like at three loops, one graph, four loop, one graph. And these relations, these Jacobi relations, propagate that information out to the entire scattering amplitude. And I'll discuss this very concretely in a little bit. Okay, so, all right, full color dressed tree level at M point. Be some over cubic graphs. As Donald said, color factors, numerator factors, some denominator factors. What's the denominator factor? What's the denominator factor? It's just going to be the contribution you get for some phi cubed theory operating on that graph. Right? Everybody with me? Yeah, okay. Good. Just so I don't have to keep writing sums over things, we can just write this, you know, some color factor vector with some denominator, some diagonal denominator vector in graphs, and some numerator. And so how does this go? With multiplicity, this is going as 2m minus 5 double factorial. This is a 2m minus 5 double factorial squared diagonal graph, and this is 2m minus 5 double factorial. But we know these guys aren't all independent, right? They satisfy Jacobi equations. What do we mean by Jacobi equations? We mean consider some arbitrary graph where my smiley face just goes out and contains the rest of the graph structure, that color factors operating on this graph are going to be color factors operating on this graph plus color factor plus the color factor of this graph, right? And, right, it doesn't matter, you know, as long as all the stuff is the same here. So this operates on every edge, right? And so color factors obey this. This is a graphical depiction of Jacobi identity. This works for all edges, right? This is what color factors do for a living. They do this in anti-symmetry. Okay, and so what can we say about this? We could say, so our color factor vector, you can write as some, you know, set of Jacobi relations acting on some set of masters. So you write down all these equations, right, for all edges contributing to tree level scattering amplitude. You can solve them in terms of m minus 2 factorial master color factors, through which linear relations, you can get all 2m minus 5 double factorial color factors. Okay, so this guy is minus 2 factorial by, you know, 2m minus 5 double factorial. All right? So color factors I can express in terms of some basis. Now, it's another way to write full color-ordered tree-level amplitudes, gauge theory, so color-dressed tree-level amplitudes, right over sum of permutations of legs 2 through m, color trace. I can go to color trace basis, where times a color-ordered tree-level amplitude, which you guys should be familiar with by now. Right, so there's some permutation over n minus 1 factorial color-ordered partial amplitudes. All right, but the fact that there's actually a basis of n minus 2 factorial Jacobi satisfied these masters that through Jacobi express everybody else actually constrains the number of independent color-ordered partial amplitudes, so that they're in fact and there's a basis, so I can write a vector of all n minus 1 factorial, so, you know, n minus 1 factorial color-ordered partial amplitudes. Turns out there's some basis, it's called the Kleist-Poiss basis, that is m minus 2 factorial by m minus 1 factorial, right? So I get to hold two legs fixed and then permute around all the rest, and using those, I can describe any one of these color-ordered partial amplitudes. All right? The world is better than that, though. What we get to do is we get to choose, for gauge theories, independent of dimension, a representation of these numerator factors that's spectacular. It is an angelic representation because it can be expressed as a Jacobi on the same set of master numerators, right? And this places a further constraint on the number of color order partial amplitudes, such that you actually have, I guess people call this the DCJ basis, the Kleist-Coif basis, you can actually express as some m minus 3 factorial by m minus 2 factorial matrix acting on some basis that, that's m minus 3. Now this guy, this matrix here just involved minus 1s, plus 1s, and zeros. This basis, this guy, this is what you get out of Jacobi relations acting on kinematic functions of external data, right? This guy depends on momentum invariance, right? So you'll express all of these guys in terms of some product of matrix invariance and some over, some reduced basis where you're holding three legs fixed.
This part is proven?
Yes. Yeah, this part is proven. This was. So if you want to see the paper, where we the paper where we guessed it was here, and we checked it to some high multiplicity, and then it was later proven using recursion. It was proven by identifying similar relations in string theory, and then dropping to lower energy limit, and then it's been proven left, right, and up and down these relations. Okay, great. So, one thing I'd like you to notice, though, is this was m minus 2 factorial, right? The number of masters, m minus 2 factorial. This is m minus 2 factorial. But the number of things that actually have independent physical information associated with the theory is m minus 3 factorial. At every multiplicity, there is m minus 2 factorial. There is m minus 2 factorial minus m minus 3 factorial. Additional freedom that is not constrained by observables at all. This is freedom of functions. Okay, what is this? This is, what's m minus 2? It's m minus 3 times m minus 2, right? So this is m minus 3 times m minus 3 factorial. Right. These are the number of functions you get that are completely unconstrained that are completely unsaturated by the constraint of Jacobi that goes as multiplicity increases. And it's this freedom that I argue you're exploiting when you find loop-level Jacobi-satisfying representations, multi-loop Jacobi-satisfying representations. This has been a little abstract, so I'm going to just do a specific example just to make it very clear.
So the m minus 3 factorial is also the number of solutions of the Skyrim.
That's directly related. That's manifestly the same degrees of freedom. You can think of the scatter equations as a diagonalization of the KLT matrix. Does somebody have a... That's how I think of it. The scatter equations diagonalize KLT,
they provide a basis to express the m minus 3 factorial amplitudes.
It's absolutely the same m minus 3 factorial. Now, you'll notice we set this up so Donald could bring you in with all this beautiful talk about classical solutions, and now I'm blathering about graphs and factorials for a little bit. I will close talk. I will say something about black holes at the end. So that'll keep your interest for the next few minutes. We'll see if it's worth it. All right, so what do I want to do? I want to, yeah, just to cement some of this in your mind, let's be very concrete. Okay, 4-point, our old friend. Okay, so what's this got? This is a color-ordered partial amplitude, right? So the only graphs that get to contribute to this have the same color order, and you can talk about them in terms of an S graph and a T graph. One, four, two, three, right? This is going to have a U graph. Does everybody know what I mean by ST and U? Maybe you guys have seen this enough already. So this is an S graph by which I mean K1, K2, K3, K4, and that momentum running here is K1 plus K2 squared equals S. 1, 2, 3, 4, T equals K2 plus K3 squared, and U equals K1, K3 squared, okay. Minus N T for T, and A, 1, 2, 4, 3, going to be exactly the same graph, but this guy twisted, so it picks up a minus sign for anti-symmetry of numerator factors, minus n over s, and it'll also have a U graph, but permuted relative to this guy, so it'll have a minus sign minus n g u over u. Okay, and so you see we've got a basis where we hold two legs fixed and we permute the other two, and we can describe this guy, right, as minus A, 1, 2, 3, 4, minus A, 1, 2, 4, 3. All right, so this is the Kleist-Coif basis, right? It's Kleist-Coif. It's the n minus 2 factorial basis that you can derive by, one, understanding the color factors obey Jacobi, and that numerator factors obey anti-symmetry. Then these color ordered partial amplitudes have a basis of dimensionality n minus 2 factorial whose coefficients are all 1, 0, minus 1. All right. Good. So let me introduce some other things I was talking about. So, okay, now I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, A, 1, 2, 4, 3. All right, here's my vector, my Kleist-Coif vector of A's. All right, this is just 1 over S, 1 over T, 0, minus 1 over S, 0, 1 over U, on S and T and U. Okay? I can impose Jacobi on this guy, right? I can express it in terms of this guy minus this guy. All right, so again, 1 over S over T, 0, minus 1 over S, 0, minus 1 over U, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1 minus 1. S and T. Huh? All right. Good. So just multiply these together, and I have. Can everybody see? Am I starting to run into the event horizon? So 1 over S, 1 over T, well, T over SU, 1 over U. And S and T equals this, right? Now, if there was no additional gauge freedom, I could just invert this matrix and get NS and NT as some combination of these guys, right? But it turns out you get this guy's singular. I can solve for NS in terms of this guy and nt, right? And that's fine. It's fair to do. I'll get ns as a function of nt and this guy. When I plug that back into here, what I'll find is that all terms depending upon nt cancel out, and I get a relationship between these two color order partial amplitudes. In fact, this guy is t over, what is it? Is it? Yes, this guy is t over u times this guy, right? So in fact, you have one basis where you fix three legs, and I can express this guy in terms of momentum invariance times this guy. And you'll notice, all right, some Jacobi satisfying ns. That's completely a function of something that's absolutely free. This function of momentum can be anything, and nothing physical will ever depend on it. I'll square these guys to get gravity. Nothing physical ever. This is pure freedom, right? And this freedom only grows as you go higher in multiplicity. At 6 points, you've got 105 graphs, 24 master graphs. Only 6 are constrained to be non-vanishing. The rest of the 18 are free functions. What are those free functions doing? Those free functions, I think, very manifestly are giving you the freedom to take your 6-point graph, look at the forward limit, and start talking about one loop 4-point in a way that manifestly obeys Jacobi. Okay, and if you guys want to talk, okay, so I should start wrapping this up. Let me make some points about why it's actually useful to have Jacobi satisfying representations when you're solving Yang-Mills theories. You only need to write down, of all the graphs of 3 loops, you only need to know how this guy contributes. And then by applying operators, mapping edges to, you know, to the relative t or the relative u off of this, you get all the numerators associated with all the graphs that contribute to 3 loops. For 4 loops, all you need to know is this guy. All you need to know is this one guy, and you've got all 82 other topologies expressed purely in terms of this guy. That, and you know, so on and so forth. These are very concrete calculations have been done. And what I'm arguing is the ability to do this is manifested at this freedom at tree level. And if you want, you can come speak to me, and I can tell you some of my ideas about how to get at this freedom very directly, very explicitly. But my point is that these relations, this double copy relations, that they go on to all loop order. All right, so. Let me close very quickly with tying back to what Donald started with. So to all multiplicity at tree level, at least, and arguably to loop level and all sorts of places we've been able to shine our light, this double copy relationship between gauge theory and gravity theories is manifest. And this was something that Ben brought up, and that Nemo was discussing, and Zvi chimed in, this question of, to what degree does the tree-level scattering matrix encode information of classical equations of motion? Solutions, classical equations of motion. I think this is something that would be very good to be discussing at our 3:30 discussion. If you take the answer that tree level S matrix elements should encode solutions to classical equations of motion, then so if you say yes, this suggests that one should expect that you should write solutions to gravitational equations of motion as some sort of convolution of Gates theory solutions. And why am I saying convolution? Because this is local in momentum space. What we see in scattering amplitudes is local in momentum space. The fact that Donal and Ricardo and Chris managed to find these beautiful local solutions is fantastic, and that gives us something that we can play with. And so So I was asked to be provocative, so I'm going to just mention something involving proving the locality, the temporal locality of these solutions. And this is something I started to look at with my good friend Gonzalo Torroba, who's now a professor in Argentina. And so what's a good test for proving the temporal locality of these solutions? Is to ask how long it takes your black holes to evaporate, and to see if you can understand that in terms of some process in gauge theory. Does anybody have any guess as to what process one might want to look at for gauge theory? Want to look at black hole evaporation?
You've got the square root of that.
Any guesses? Well, I'll tell you. So I don't have an answer. I don't have a fully worked out story. But what we're looking at Schwinger pair production and charge screening. So all I'll say is that if you couple, semi-classically. I mean, semi-classically. So you've got a. So what does Donal tell us? He tells us, a stationary black hole is dual in some sense to a stationary charge. Okay. We close our eyes. Something happened. And all of a sudden, my black hole's a little smaller, right? You can say, okay, if I close my eyes and I look again, is my gauge theory a little smaller, and is it happening at the same rate? Is my charge a little smaller? Is it happening at the same rate?
The square of screening is screening.
And the square of screening is screening.
Well, what is screening?
This is just an observation, right? If I have some massive scalar field of mass m, right? And I can ask, what's the rate around the horizon of a production of pairs of these massive charged particles? And it goes as, minus m over the Hawking temperature, right? Goes as. okay, what's the Hawking temperature? The Hawking temperature, m Planck squared over m. Okay, now I say I've got some charge. This is not abelian. This holds for Yang Mills, but in this case, if it's just one charge, it coulombizes, right? So in my gauge theory, right, coupled to some scalar field with charge Q and mass little m, right, pair production at the same distance minus m squared over Q electric field, right? What's electric field? Right. Well, Donal tells us we should identify the m with the q. So electric field is q over r squared, m over m squared, 1 over m. If my scalar field has mass equal q, mass equal charge, little m equal little q, then this is the same rate of production as a black hole.
What's the formation process?
I don't know. This is all I have to say. We just started looking at this, and it's not a complete story. There are all sorts of issues.
But if you answer the first question, you've answered that, right? Because
yeah.
You put in sources that form a black hole. And
there you go. I know we're getting very close to cookies, but I'd be happy to talk more about this during the discussion.
regions with